Hi, I'm Travis. Thanks for tuning into our TV program today. We hope you'll not only be inspired and uplifted, but that you'll check out one of our Sunday services. It's always good to be hanging out with Jared Dudley. Jared, thanks for being on the show with us today. Man, you know, to start out, I was noticing, man, this shoe down here. What's this about, man? Gucci shoes?
You know, I got a couple of these hanging around. I took those to the golf tournament. I got them all dirty, so I'm trying to take them in to get it clean.
All right. What size are those there? Those...
I'm a 15. I'm 15. A men's 15, okay, so not too big.
Kind of small for the NBA.
Yeah, for the NBA.
So, Jared, man, tell us, you know, just you're a Phoenix Sun now, and you've been in the Valley now for a couple years anyway.
Two and a half years now.
2.5 years, and tell me about, you know, life in the Valley.
You know, for me, obviously being raised in San Diego, to come back to the West Coast is really big for me because my wife's family's from California, my family's from California. It's always a quick Southwest ticket away, which is very affordable. But I like it here, and I'm not just saying that because I signed my contract. I like it for one, the weather.
Right.
It's warm. I love being in the West Coast. For two, when it comes to the arena and fans,
right.
You know, out of 31 teams, you know, maybe half of them have a good crowd.
Yeah.
I came from Charlotte where it wasn't sold out. These fans are sold out 95% of the times. They actually know what they're talking about. And then I would say the other would be obviously the organization and our teammates having a good feel of, you know, of older veterans with Grant Hill and G. We right. had Jay Rich and then young guys. And the food, I mean, restaurants, as people know my Twitter, I go out, eat all different, family owned, when it comes to upscale, when it comes to healthy, and it has it all here.
Right. Yeah, you are, I would say you're the fans player. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the Valley, there's been a lot of players throughout the years, mm-hmm. and in my time with the Phoenix Suns, probably the last 9.5, 10 years, mm-hmm. But you are definitely like the fans player. And in Twitter, I think is a great way that, you know, you reach back out to the fans and you can communicate and connect with them. And take me through that process. I mean, what kind of made you want to do that?
You know, I didn't even know what Twitter was. Shaq had it. And I remember he got in trouble for it, but I didn't remember what happened. It was just one day I was actually in Vegas with my boy in the summertime. I said, man, everybody's on Twitter. It might be time to get on Twitter.
Right.
And for me, I thought it'd be perfect for my personality to be able to hang out with fans, talk to them. And my personality is, I let people, you know, get to know me. So it's right. not like I'm a hold back when it comes to sports, to giveaways, and I kind of make my teammates sometimes feel uncomfortable in a way that I feel like we're obligated. We're obligated as athletes to let ourselves open up to these fans just because you get paid a lot of money.
Right.
You get to have the dream job. I know that
right.
When I was a kid growing up, I always wanted to know what's the life of an NBA player, and it's better than what you think, and it's not as good as what you think. It's
right,
both. So,
right.
So I want to kind of open up to people.
Well, now if you take away, you know, the money,
mm-hmm.
and you just take, you know, venue for venue,
mm-hmm.
What is more exhilarating? Is it playing at Boston College or playing in the NBA?
That's a good question. I would say overall the experience of fans is better in college,
mm-hmm.
but there's definitely some arenas, especially when it comes to when you go to Lakers and Hollywood and you got, you know, Denzel and Tom
right.
Hanks
right.
and, you know, Tom Cruise, and then Boston when it comes to, I mean, the Boston Celtics arena is like, obviously, you know, you got to add the college fans plus the NBA fans, the tradition, it's
yeah.
loud. And then you got places like Portland and Utah where it might not be, you know, the best place to live where you want to live, but you know
right.
what? It's packed, it's loud. So for me, I think the college experience is just a lot of kids that, you know, are just dying for their alma mater and
right.
just being loud. And you never know what they did the night before or night after. So it's good times.
Right. Well, you know, let's talk about your baby mm-hmm. for just a moment.
Yeah.
You have a wonderful family.
Yes.
And you're married to Chrissy, Christina. And she's an awesome woman.
Mm-hmm.
And you're a new daddy, a newer mm-hmm. daddy. What is it like, you know, being a father?
You know what? To be honest with you, it's for me the biggest accomplishment I've ever had. And the reason why I say accomplishment is because you now have brought something that's yours into this world. It's something that
right.
You're responsible for, something you need to be responsible for. It's something that it's so hard to describe in the sense of like, you're coming home, you see her face. She doesn't care if you had a bad day or a good day. What you do is sets the foundation for her life. And that's right. A huge responsibility. And so I take really, really to heart.
Right.
And when it comes to learning, putting stuff in her mind. And I, you know what? I wish I would have had some earlier. But I think it was God's will, having the right time after you're married.
Right.
It was for me, just, you know, coming to Phoenix the right time. And hopefully I have more just like her and healthy.
Yeah, well, how many are you thinking you guys want to have?
Minimum three, max four. I think, you know, you never want to, if you have three and they're twins and you have five and you're mad and I don't want that. Right. But I mean, as long as I can support them, be there for them mentally, physically, spiritually, man, I'll have as many as I can.
Yeah, well, that's great. You know, the Phoenix Suns have, you know, just such a great organization. Mm-hmm. I've heard it from so many people throughout the years, players that have come and gone mm-hmm. to different teams, and they talk about that family component, you know, and one of the things I think that's a must for pro athletes, whether it's NBA, NFL, MLB, whatever it be, for all the travel, mm-hmm. is that organizations really embrace the idea of family and supporting mm-hmm. a family structure. You know, as a family man, mm-hmm. what would you say the biggest obstacle is with the career that you have?
As a family man, I would say, for one, you have to have your wife or girlfriend or whoever you have with you at that time to be a strong person while you're gone. Mm-hmm. And that's crucial, just because you are gone throughout the time. You know, you have summers off, you're gone through 6 months, 3 months out of the year.
Right.
And, you know, either they have to be home with the kids. So in a way, they have to be a father-like figure to that kid to be able to be a disciplinarian and someone who's, you know, compassionate. So I would say the time away from your kids, because you can come back after, you know, a week and a half too, and you don't want to mess the routine up. And, and my daughter's only 16, 17 months, and, you know, I might want to go take her to the park, but she has a class here, or my wife has to do that. So I think communications is crucial in a relationship, but I would think that having your wife, showing her support that, hey, you know what, hey, when I'm not here, you got to run the family.
Right, that's good. Now, speaking of your wife, let's mm-hmm. just have a little fun with this.
Yes.
If you could tell your wife anything on television right now, what would that be?
I would say just thank you for putting up with me. I mean, obviously, this lifestyle, this business, even this world is even crazier than everything. That, you know, for her being there for me through thick and thin is, you know, for one, I thank her for that. I thank God for blessing me with you, and hopefully we can have many more beautiful years.
Awesome.
Yes.
Well, awesome. And, you know, speaking of family life, you know, one of the things that I firmly believe and teach is obviously mm-hmm. that church is a big part of family, the Bible, mm-hmm. and shaping your family life and kind of a foundation for living. Mm-hmm. You guys attend church. I know that you've grown up, you know, attending church and different things to at least some degree. Mm-hmm. And now that you guys are in Phoenix, you attend Desert Life Church. Mm-hmm. What are the things about Desert Life Church that you would just say, you know, these are the things that my family and I, mm-hmm. we probably love the most about the church?
Love the most? I mean, that's a good question. I think for my wife, to be able to have leave your kids. I mean, obviously we have a newborn somewhat, to be able to leave your kids and feel safe. I mean,
right.
You don't want to be able to drop your kids off anywhere. In some places, you know, it could be church. Some places might not be as safe as others.
Yeah.
So I think for her, the comfortability knowing that, hey, your child's okay.
Right.
Now you can, you know, focus your attention on the worship.
Right.
I would say for two, another factor would be, you know, for me personally, I like to have different, you know, singing in the beginning, singing in the end. You got to have a mixture. So I think the mixture between the word and the worship with the singing and praising, because I think we all praise, you know, God. We all want, you know, the best for each other. And I would say the sermons. I would say they always have something new. If it comes to videos,
right?
If it comes to for me personally, ex-athletes talking about their prior experiences,
right?
And then I think you do a good job of, hey, not only giving information, which a lot of pastors can do. You have to have scripture to back it up, and
right.
And saying it in your own way. It's kind of, I think the hardest thing about the Bible is to know what the Bible's saying and try to what's the word I'm looking for?
Maybe like apply it.
Yeah, not even apply it, just to be able to explain it.
Yeah.
I think, you know, that's where, you know, pastors separate themselves. I think you do a good job of explaining it in your words.
Yeah, oh, that's a good point. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and obviously the whole idea of church is God.
Yeah.
So, you know, in your life as a family man, a husband, a father, you know, a professional, an athlete, you know, what is the importance of God to you in your life?
Well, it started at a young age. You know, I messed around with my dad and my, you know, and my wife about it, that you get to someone to kind of throw it in your face at first. So my mom made us go to church. It was forced.
Right.
I went to Catholic school when I was younger.
Right.
I went to a Christian school, not only for God, but for basketball. It was more mainly basketball than God, just because I didn't know at a young age.
Right.
And then once I was there, I had Bible class. So then I got the information, like, hey, this is what Christianity is really about.
Yeah.
We had a class every day. So I got the foundation. And then you go, then after that, they throw you in the real world where, hey, you're in college now, you have temptations, this. So God for me is definitely a huge part. It's number one. But it's easy for anyone to say it's number one.
Yeah.
How I try to go about it is, you know, when you're doing right, when you're wrong.
Right.
I try to ask for forgiveness when I'm wrong and try to improve on those things. Because usually for me, everyone's different. You know, it's always a couple areas where, hey, these are the things I struggle with.
Right.
These are the ones, hey, I'm pretty good at. Hey, I could be better, but hey, I feel good about myself.
Right.
So I try to be an example for my family. But luckily enough, my wife's even ahead of me. I'm trying to catch her.
Well, man, if you could tell basically Arizona anything that you wanted to tell them today, it doesn't have to be about God, spiritually, just anything, you know, what would you tell them?
What would I tell them? I would say, you know, life's too short, you know, to have enemies. Life's too short to not have fun in this world. You never know when you're going to leave. Me, personally, I think about the afterlife. I think about in the present. So for me, I think just having fun, but yet having responsibility if it comes to anything. There's responsibility for my kids, my wife, my walk. I have a responsibility. You have a responsibility to yourself to have fun and do it the right way. So, I mean, that would be my thing, is keep doing what you're doing, improve on what you can, and just take responsibility.
Right, awesome. Well, there you have it, man. Interview with Phoenix Suns' very own Jared Dudley. JD, man, thanks so much for being
thanks
here.
Thanks for having me.
Genuinely, sincerely mean it. And Phoenix loves you, man. I'm sure you know that.
Yes.
But keep doing what you're doing, and we'll continue to pray for you.
Yes.
All right, God bless.
John 3:16, the Bible says that God so loved the world that whosoever, what? Believes will have eternal life. Mark 1:15 says that the time has come and the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Mark 9:23, it says that all things are possible to those who believe. And then Romans 10:9 says, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, and you shall be saved. And so believe is a big concept, but the opposite of believe is unbelief. And unbelief is also a pretty big deal in the Bible. And in Joshua 3, I wanna just kind of paint the canvas for a minute, the backdrop of what is going on, is that the Bible says that if you look in the book of Numbers, Moses was leading the children of Israel, and God had told Moses and the children of Israel, in fact, he told Abraham 500 years before Joshua had this moment, that you're going to go into the promised land. I'm promising you the promised land, which is this land of Canaan. And the Bible says that Moses was the leader of these Israelites, and Moses, in Numbers, the Bible says, did not get to enter the promised land because of two reasons: disobedience and unbelief. disobedience and unbelief. As a matter of fact, God told Moses that I want to show you the promised land, but you can't go into the promised land. He took him up on Mount Nebo and he shows Moses this beautiful promised land. And God loved Moses. In fact, the Bible says that God loved Moses, and Moses was the only one that had a face-to-face relationship with God. So much so that the Bible says there was no other prophet ever before or to come like Moses. God loved Moses. Moses had God's favor. But Moses, because of disobedience and unbelief, did not get to enter the promised land. One of the greatest tragedies that anyone could have in life is to live your life and never discover the destiny for your life. And even worse than that would be to know what your destiny is, but to forfeit your destiny because of disobedience or unbelief. Joshua was Israel's next leader. It was Moses who died just short of the goal line, just short of the end zone, just short of the promised land, and God raised up a new leader called Joshua. Joshua was a powerful man. He was full of God. He loved God. He was obedient to God. He had been with Moses for many, many years. He had seen the miracles of God, and now he was ready to lead 2.5 million people across the finish line and into the promised land. However, before they could enter this land, it was Canaan, before they could enter the land, they had a major obstacle in the way, and that major obstacle was the Jordan River. Everybody say Jordan. The Jordan was in the way. And so normally this wouldn't have been much of a problem because they said that the Jordan was about 100 feet wide. And the difference, though, was that today is that God seems to set us up, doesn't he? That we can't do anything on our own, that nothing powerful can be accomplished, that we could boast, that man could boast, but that we would have to give all the praise and all the credit to God, and this crossing would be no exception. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that God brought them to the Jordan River at harvest time, which meant that the Jordan would swell to this insurpassable amount, and it would be now about a mile wide, this raging river. And the only way they could cross this river was with supernatural help. Listen, I want to tell you this today, that everybody in here today, if not today, someday in the future, to receive the promise that God has for you, and he has one for you, to walk into that destiny that God has called for you to walk into, to move into that promise that God has, that purpose that he has for your life, make no mistake about it, that there will be a Jordan that will be between you and that purpose for your life. There will be a raging river in between you and the destiny that God has for you, and that is exactly what is going on here. I want to just tell you that Jordan is a place that is God ordained. It's a place of impossibility. It's a place of weakness. It's a place of absolute helplessness. And it's the place where all self-effort dies. And only by the grace and the power and the leading and the anointing of God could you ever cross that Jordan. The Jordan is a dividing line. It's a place that we're forced to decide if we're going to believe God or not believe God. It's the place where we die short of living our destinies, or it's the place that we live in the promises that God has planned for us. And everyone in this room, to truly fulfill the purpose in your life, you will need to cross a Jordan. Everybody say Jordan. Three keys to crossing the Jordan that I want to talk to you about today. When it comes to the Jordan in your life and you have to cross this significant obstacle, this hurdle that can literally take you down and drown you and kill you, three keys. Number one is that you've got to examine God's message for your life. You see, God has a message for everybody in here. God has a word for your life. God's message is always available and it's always on time. You know, we're all around messages every day. We hear messages, they come from everywhere, from text message, phone message, Facebook message, Twitter message, email message, mom messages, dad messages, brother, sister, friend messages. We hear messages all day, but when it comes to God's message, you have to pay attention to who the messenger is. Because a lot of messengers are far from God, not even purposefully, but they're presenting you with messages that have nothing to do with God. We hear messages all day. We're being told what to do by all sorts of people. My question for you is, who is the messenger? What is their angle? Your messenger should be the Word of God, the Holy Spirit. You know, it's interesting because God's Word, it always involves a challenge. It always involves a challenge for your life and for my life. And you know, first of all, I would be of disservice if I didn't tell you that every promise comes with a price. Every promise, there's no victory without a fight, and there's no testimony without a test. There's no crown without a cross, and there's no resurrection without a crucifixion, right? There's no healing without sickness, and there's no deliverance without a fire. And there's something that you will have to go through to get through your promise. Joseph went to the palace. He went to the pit. He went to prison. And before the three Hebrew boys were promoted, they went through the fiery furnace between the children of Israel and their inheritance. The promised land was a river called Jordan. You know, it's interesting. You might write it down, but did you know what Jordan means? The word Jordan, what the word Jordan means, it means descender. It means the one that takes you down. Descender, the one that takes you down. And that is what Jordan intends to do, is to take you down, to kill your dreams, to drown your faith. And there's a Jordan for every one of us. We need to examine God's message for our life and realize that it is a challenge. The second thing is that it involves commands. God's message involves commands, not only commands on you and on me, but commands from God, promises that he's made for us. In Joshua 3, chapter 5, if you'll look at that particular scripture, Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. You know, the people were told to consecrate themselves. In other words, sanctify yourself. Set yourselves apart. Get ready, because I'm about to do something powerful. Don't look to the left. Don't look to the right. Remember in Joshua chapter 1, meditate on the Lord day and night. Meditate on his word. Don't get distracted. Don't become unbelieving. I've got something for you, but you've got to stay the course. You have to keep your focus. Stay on track. The Bible says that God gives a promise. He gives a command. His command is to consecrate yourselves. And if you consecrate yourself, if you set yourself apart, Romans chapter 12 says that we are not to conform to the pattern of the world. There is a pattern of sin in the world that looks enticing and it looks tasty, but it leads to death. It's a trap. The Spirit of God is gonna make a way where there seems to be absolutely no way for you to cross that Jordan. I don't care if the waters are raging. I don't care if it looks like it can't be done. I don't care what it sounds like, looks like, feels like. I am telling you that I have a command for you. And when those pastors step foot in that water, you are gonna see something like you have never seen before. Why? Because the Word of God is alive. The Word of God is active. This message to the Israelites was reminding them that God was God and that they were not. I mean, have you ever looked at a situation, an obstacle in your life, and you go, I have no idea how I'm going to get through that. No idea how I can live another day like that. I have no clue. And God says, that's good, because I know how you can do it. All you have to do is believe in me and trust in me, because I have the plan. I have the plan. It wasn't Joshua's problem. It was God's problem. In these verses, God gives them a commitment. He makes them a promise. And he tells them that he will bring them through in a powerful fashion. The second key to crossing the Jordan today is that we must expect God's miracle for our lives. Remember, there is no testimony without a test, and there was a test. There was a problem. The problem was that the Jordan was at flood stage. It was during harvest, and yet as soon as the priests who carried the ark reached the Jordan, their feet touched the water's edge, and even though God gave his message, there was still a major problem. They stood at the edge of the raging Jordan River at flood stage, and you know, it could have kept anyone at bay, but they expected God's miracle for their lives. You know, the devil tries to mess with your expectations. Expectations are an enormously powerful concept for your life and for my life. And if he can get you to stop expecting, if he can paralyze your expectation, then he can paralyze you moving forward as a man, a woman of God. If he can paralyze and shut it down and say, you have no more expectation. God can't do this. You've never seen him do this before. What would make you think he would do this now? You've never been up against a Jordan like this ever in your entire life. Do you really think that God can do that? And you begin to listen to all the other messengers that are pumping nonsense into your head, and you begin to buy into it, and you go, you know what? I don't know if God can do it. And you're defeated before you ever let your feet touch the waters. I know most of us, we say, well, God has a plan, God has a promise, and he better perform now. Right? We got to have it now. 500 years later, obedience, belief is a powerful concept. It's interesting because it says that the priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan, while all Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed the crossing on dry ground.
Jesus is alive.